Welcome to CS76. We've got some guest lecturers for tonight. First, remind people that who probably don't need reminding that the next student project is due Wednesday. And now I'll turn things over to our Microsoft evangelist and his friends.
All right, cool. And my friends. You are my friends. I have three friends in the world, and these are them. So thank you, everyone, for joining me. My name is Edwin Guarin. I'm the Senior Academic Developer Evangelist for Higher Education New England. It does say that on my business card. With me, I have three people that I'm really excited to present to you. First is Dean Andrews from Nokia, Todd Mancini, he's from Microsoft, and Jim O'Neill from Microsoft. We're going to be talking to you about Windows Phone development. But because we had this recent partnership with Nokia, I felt that it might be appropriate to invite them along and kind of let you know what's going on with Nokia and Microsoft. And I'll let Dean start. I'll do an introduction on sort of Windows Phone development. I have a bit.ly link for your class to share. And then we'll lead to Todd and Jim, who are going to be talking about pretty cool things. So go ahead, Dean.
Hello again. Thank you to JP and to Edwin. And thank you for your time here today. Again, I am Dean Andrews. I work in business development in Nokia. I stole these slides from a recent deck that we showed at Mobile World Congress in March in Barcelona, but I knew I was coming to Harvard, so I wanted to make sure I had the bibliography correct here. So the idea of this, to cut to the chase, is to get you to think about the Windows Phone ecosystem as a viable third ecosystem for app development. I know that there are obvious reasons that people go with iOS and with Android, namely the market share, for example, of those platforms. But tonight, I'm hoping that we can make you think about Windows Phone. For a quick level set, how many of you here today have ever laid hands on a Windows Phone device? Okay, not many, but no, that's, and how many of you have ever owned a Nokia phone? All right, so most of you have owned a Nokia phone. That's interesting. All right, very good. So, to be brutally frank with you, I can go back briefly and talk about the history of Nokia. In the early 2000s, Nokia had 40% market share in the United States for mobile handsets. But as you are probably well aware, we're nowhere near that point right now. Nokia made some missteps in the early 2000s, and we had two very smart companies, Apple and Google, come into this market in the United States and kick us in the head, product-wise, with very good products. But Nokia itself is not made up of dummies, and we didn't fall over and die when this happened. What we did is plot our comeback. And the comeback has already begun. And if I were to sum up Nokia's current strategy in two simple phrases, it would be these: that we have partnered with Microsoft, and that we are going to reemerge in the smartphone space in the United States, and I'll talk about globally a little bit later. We're going to reemerge with this third ecosystem, Windows Phone, in the United States in this partnership. And then we will also continue to leverage our global assets and resources, and that we will basically connect the next billion out there who can't afford the expensive smartphones that people use in the United States. But we intend to connect them with Nokia products around the world. These are two of our current Windows Phone products. Now, again, just for kind of level setting here, we announced our partnership with Microsoft in February of 2011. So in little over a year, we have released four Windows Phone products. The two that are available in the United States are the Lumia 710, which is currently available on T-Mobile, and the Lumia 900 here on the right that is available at AT&T. It is the 900 product here is the first 4G LTE Windows phone available. The 610 and the 800, which I'm going to show you in the at a moment, are available in other parts of the world and really intended for other markets. But it shows you again that Nokia is able to produce many different handsets, all kind of variations on a theme, extremely quickly. It's one of our strengths. These are 10 of the 13 awards that the Nokia Lumia 900 has won. And this is, we announced this phone in January at the Consumer Electronics Show, where we won, CNET hosting the entire show, we won the Best Smartphone Award. And it's basically been lauded with awards since its release. Many of the awards were granted before the phone was available to the public, which has been just about a week on AT&T. But again, I think it speaks to the quality of Nokia products. And I know they haven't been available in the United States in recent years, so many previous Nokia owners have kind of forgotten about the quality and engineering that Nokia produces, but we hope to remind them now. This strategy that we have to kickstart this third Windows Phone ecosystem, in my own humble opinion, is quite amazing. And I know I'm a little biased, but each week as I learn about kind of new facets of it, I'm quite amazed. This is one of the facets of it here regarding the app ecosystem. I'll talk about some stats on the Windows Phone marketplace in a minute. But one of the things we're doing is to partner with very well-known and loved brands like these. And one of the ways we're differentiating our Nokia phones from other makers' Windows phones are to have exclusive apps for a time window. So these partners here have created exclusive Nokia Windows Phone apps for a limited amount of time, and then the apps will be available to any Windows phone in the Windows marketplace. But for that time, they're available, for a limited time, they're available on only Nokia Windows phones, and each of these apps has features or functionality that is only available on Nokia Windows phones and not in the same applications on iOS or Android. So we're partnering with major brands, but also creating distinctive experiences that we hope will excite people. One of the other things we're doing is just high visibility. Because of the dominance of iOS and Android in the United States, we have to be disruptive. And so we are, again, choosing channels and in media events which are disruptive. One a sample of this has been Red Bull. They're very dramatic in their outdoor events and their advertising. So we have partnered with them to raise attention there in their kind of Red Bull app. This, I had the great pleasure of experiencing myself. This was two Fridays ago in Times Square in New York City, where we basically shut down Times Square with a concert. It was complete gridlock of people and vehicles. And we also took over 9 of the major digital billboards that sweep up the skyscrapers in Times Square. And the concert was by Nicki Minaj, who is a top hip-hop and pop artist. But again, what's smart about this is that the reason that we partnered with Nicki Minaj is because she is the 11th most followed person in the world on Twitter. And that we also invited the very most followed microbloggers in the world, and we took them to a VIP viewing area to watch this concert. So we are engaging both in mainstream media and also social media to kind of get the word out. And again, since January, where we've really kind of kicked off this major effort in the United States, it's working quite dramatically. These are just more images from the Nicki Minaj. I took this one myself. This was a pro photographer. So, how are we doing? Well, I think we're doing quite well. There are three independent industry analysts, high-tech and mobile industry analysts, that forecast by the year 2015 that the Windows Phone ecosystem will be number two in market share in the United States. And number one in their forecast is Android, not iOS. We've had incredible success with our two carrier entries on T-Mobile with the Lumia 710 and AT&T. T-Mobile has increased their orders for the Lumia 710 twice since January. And if you've been watching the news, the high-tech news in particular, the AT&T phone stores across the country have sold out of the Lumia 900. I'm not saying the entire country, but many of the stores have sold out of the device. Real end users who actually own these devices are giving us incredibly high ratings, like 4 out of 5 stars from T-Mobile users, and the earliest reviews of the people using the 900 and AT&T, they basically love it. And we have a ton of positive reviews in the mainstream press from the New York Times, David Pogue, Boston Globe, Hiawatha Bray, CNET, Engadget, on and on and on. This is some of the success we've had just in impacting the Windows Phone marketplace. This is year-over-year increase in the apps in the Windows Phone marketplace, 300% year-over-year. There are other stats that the Windows Phone marketplace was the fastest to reach 50,000 apps of any app store, including iOS and Android. We are now, I believe the last published number was 80,000 apps. And the rate of growth, apps submitted per day, it's my understanding that it is currently higher than either iOS or Android marketplaces. This is, our strategy is number one to basically impact the market share in the United States. But our partnership with Microsoft is global. And we have announced recently, I believe it was a Mobile World Congress, 22 different markets in which we will be selling the Nokia Windows Phone products. So as an opportunity for developers, there's real potential here. And about kickstarting this ecosystem, my job is particularly focused on apps for the Windows Phone marketplace. And I can tell you that we work hard to overcome some of the challenges that developers face in the other popular ecosystems. There are discoverability problems in the iOS App Store. Many new apps just get lost. There are piracy problems in the Android marketplace. And we hope to address, and we are addressing, both of those in the Windows Phone marketplace. And one thing we do is to work with app developers to opportunistically promote applications far and wide. This is one example in which we publicized this game, Doodle, which was the winner of a Nokia Windows Phone Hackfest. And we promoted it far and wide, dramatically increased the sales of the app. We are, again, there's multi-market proposition in terms of not just having apps available to be sold in the United States, and we have resources to assist there. And this, for Nokia, obviously there are there's a major Microsoft site, but we connect to that through our developer.nokia.com site. This is the Nokia Lumia 800 device. And again, you can purchase this unlocked over the web, but it's available through carriers in Europe, in the UK. Again, I would face off Nokia hardware with any hardware maker on Earth. And I urge you to take the time, if you haven't already seen one of these devices in person, urge you to visit a AT&T or T-Mobile store to check it out for yourself. It's got just an incredible unibody construction. It's an incredibly durable phone, like all Nokia products. I've personally dropped this device accidentally about 10 times, and there's not a crack, not a problem with the device. We have the amazing Carl Zeiss optics. This is an 8-megapixel camera on this, and there is also an 8-megapixel on the Lumia 900 at AT&T. It's got this AMOLED display with clear black, and if you see this, it doesn't do it justice on this document reader, but if you see it up close, the screen appears to float kind of off the top of the device. It's quite amazing. Again, this whole Microsoft thing is working out beautifully. The partnership with them, this is an incredibly snappy OS on this device and amazingly powerful. This is the home screen here, and this is the list of apps that are installed on the device. There are many differences between iOS, Android, and this, and it is my opinion and the opinion of others that this is much fresher. The iPhone absolutely, no question about, rocked the world when it came out, but it hasn't changed a lot since then. And this, in many people's opinions, particularly designers and even app developers, talk about how this has a lot of amazing new kind of learnings and elements about user interaction. One of those is the live tiles, which you see here, which are not dead icons, but are constantly updated with new information. I was talking with Edwin that I kind of made the mistake of looking at all my recent messages while I was waiting before class here. But these tiles, they'll show you right on the tile here on the home screen, recent calls, recent the newest text messages, new email, and other things, so that you don't have to dig into anything to see what's going on. This app here, this Nantasket Beach, is actually real-time surf report from Nantasket Beach pumped to this live tile. And you can also, with this operating system, I can pin, it's called, anything to this home screen that I need to know. The information about my next trip, my boss's conference call information, a particular web page I'm looking at, almost anything, an app that I can, you know, kind of promote to this higher level, like Netflix, or many other things. A couple other quick features. Instead of diving into different elements to find out social network updates from my circle or people I follow on Twitter, this OS integrates it all into this river, and it's constantly updated, so I can quickly see what it is I need to know. I can quickly see who has reached out to me, and I can look through or search all my list of contacts. Another amazing thing that people love is this integration. Instead of diving into different apps to see the businesses and places that are around me, you can do that here with this local search, this local scout. The music icon there is a Shazam-like service to tell you what music it is you're listening to. The next one is for scanning barcodes on products to find out more about them. And the last one is voice input for searching. All this stuff tightly integrated, no need to jump around and find applications. Let's see, very quickly, last thing for me is this Metro UI. Again, designers and app developers and end users love it. It's this flowing panorama that actually has depth to it. It's also, in the designer terms, it's non-decorated, like things on iOS where there's arrows that tell you, oh, you can move here or slide this over. It's just a very natural, beautiful interface, and it's integrated tightly into the apps and services that come on the device, and it's also open to app developers to use, to develop. That's all I got. I know we have a lot of other information here, but thank you for your time.
Do you have a moment for a couple of questions?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Definitely.
This seems predominantly to be aimed at more of a consumer rather than enterprise. Is that the direction that you seem to be going, or are you moving towards both?
It's a very good question, and we are moving to, the question is, I have to repeat the questions. The question is, this seems to be consumer focused. Is that our intended direction, or is there a business enterprise element to this? And the answer is that we are focused on both. I'm sure Microsoft has their own answer to this. But I can tell you that we are engaging with companies that are both kind of consumer-focused companies in terms of apps and also business-focused companies. And if you look, you know, there's a tight integration to Microsoft Office products as well as Xbox, which I realize is consumer-focused. And I think what we're trying to kind of look toward from Nokia's perspective is that one phone that does both in people's lives. Any other questions?
So if you develop for the Lumia platform, will that run on all Windows phones?
Yes, so the question is, will apps developed for the Lumia platforms run on every Windows phone? The answer is absolutely yes. Any other questions?
You mentioned that some applications have features specific to Nokia.
Yes.
You mentioned those four or five applications. What specific things that for the Nokia that won't be on another Windows phone for the same application?
So they will. The question is, what features are exclusive to Nokia on the apps that I mentioned? And the answer is that there is nothing exclusive to Nokia Windows Phone applications that will not be available on all Windows phones. All of the exclusivity is just a time box. And so I believe, if I understand it correctly, CNN app, for example, has a whole iReport feature where people can submit a news report information that they come across that is, I understand, currently not available on any other platform, at least in the way it's implemented here. And again, for now, it's exclusive to Nokia Windows phones, but will soon be available on any Windows phone. Any other questions? Yes?
How is the, when suppose the new version comes, like Windows 8 on the phone?
Yes.
How fast will it have the download available to upgrade, like, you know, the Nokia device or any other device?
So the question is, when the new version of Windows Phone, are you asking about? When the new version of Windows Phone comes out, how quickly will you be able to upgrade the device? And in that's a question I can't answer today because we don't have any of the new versions of Windows Phone available. So it's something I can certainly go back and talk to people about, but I don't have that answer today. Okay? All right. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks a lot, Dean. So actually, I just wanted to add to what Dean was talking about, some of the features that I like to use and that I feel is pretty cool in terms of personalization on the devices before I go into opening up Visual Studio. So Chris saw this earlier, but I just got married about a month and a half ago. Still married, thank God, but forgot my ring. Oh, yeah, this is online, too, so I could show my wife that I still say good words about her. So this is the home screen, but one of the things that really is important to me is, you know, I could keep track of my wife. I call her my wife now. So one of the things, you know, that I could do is, first of all, you know, if I go to the pictures page for Francine. I can actually link and find out all the pictures on her Facebook page, so I don't have to open up a Facebook app and then find my wife and then go to pictures. Everything is already integrated into the phone. One of the big things, too, she always tells me, you know, you never listen to what I say, you forget what I told you. There's a history, right? I go to her, and it tells me today what exactly, is there anything inappropriate here? Okay. but, you know, exactly what happened today, what happened last week, how many missed calls I have from her. So I could go directly. So, for example, this is text. I can go see what's up with text. I can see what time. Well, actually, I don't have any cell phone connection, so I can't really do that. But you know what I mean? I can sort of break it down from text to emails to voicemails. And one of the things that I love on this phone that isn't on any other Windows phone at the moment is visual voicemail. So on the iPhone, you have visual voicemail. And over here, oops, I got to go to phone. I can go to voicemail. So I don't have to, you know, dial my voicemail number, hit one to skip messages. It's already automatically here. Right, so I can tell who I have messages from. So I have a group of friends that I continuously connect with. Again, I'm not online, but these are things called live tiles. And anytime that there's a Facebook or status update, these actually flip over and it tells you directly what their status update is. So again, I don't have to open up Facebook. I don't have to click on my friend or look at the news feeds. It is automatically there for the people I care about. Same thing, I can text everyone. I click on text. It has everyone's, you know, everyone's on the to line. It does group text messaging, so you can see in one thread who it's connecting with. Same thing with email. I could send email to everyone using which account. I have many Hotmail accounts, as you could tell. Now, if I want to creep on my friends, right, and I want to see what's up with them, only these eight people that I really care about, I can go to what's new. And it takes the content from Facebook specifically for these people that I care about, and it takes that content and puts it onto this page. And then now I can, for you know everything, I can make a comment on it. I just click on the plus. I could like it. Again, for the people that I really care about. So it's all about making this connection, you know, a couple of less taps on different apps and into one integrated experience. Same thing here. For pictures, right, albums from these eight people that I care about, I go to the albums. It's all cached. So these are photos specifically from those eight friends I care about. So it really does make this experience personal to me and to what I'm trying to accomplish. Instead of, you know, going to an app and then finding out. Unfortunately, I don't have a wireless connection. There are a couple of things I could show you. Same thing for weather, right? This weather app, stocks app, they kind of flip and tell you what's the latest update. That weather app updates every half an hour, so you could see different cities, what the current temperature is, and if there's rain or any precipitation in the area. So again, I don't have to open up the app and then look at my city, etc. Everything's right there on the home screen for you to access really quickly. So I'm sure there's other things I could show you, but I'm going to move on to get some code going. Next thing I'm going to do is actually I'm going to show you a couple of things specifically for you. If you go to bit.ly/e-76phone. So for those of you, bit.ly/e-76, today's course number phone. It'll bring you to this really quick site that I created. So how many of you are sort of in the industry working? You're either a part-time or full-time job, right? I think pretty much all of you, right? You guys are pro devs. You are not undergrads. But if you are a student, you can actually create a developer account for free. So while you have your .edu address, I suggest that you do this. Maybe my company will hate me because I'm saying, hey, you could get this for free instead of paying $99. But I think for the iPhone and the Android, you have to pay like $99 and $29 to have a student account, a developer account. So this tab shows you a couple of things. I don't think we're going to go into XNA development, but these are really good resources into getting XNA development or game development on the phone for your phone or Xbox. And some of the code samples for you to get jump-started. There's actually a video series called the Mango Jumpstart video series, and there's code samples. So for each of those videos, there are links to code samples. So if I click on those code samples, right, it has both the presentations and the code that is used in these video samples. And I'm going to show you one of these samples later on. It's pretty helpful. There's a Silverlight toolkit, which I could show you in a second as well. Are you going to do the Silverlight toolkit? I was just going to pop it up. Okay, good. I'll let you do that then. So, you know, these are specific things and links that are specifically for students, but you as a full-time pro dev, but you have an EDU account, I would say take advantage of it. We also have this promotion, so if you want a Nokia Lumia 800 device, we have a couple of these remaining. If you publish three apps in the marketplace and they are published, send either myself, Jim, or Todd an email, and we'll send you a phone device as long as we have some remaining. So it's a 3-for-1 promotion. Let's see, while you have your EDU address as well. So let me go ahead and start. I'm going to show you what you could do with Visual Studio in one line of code, both from straight up Silverlight, and I'm going to show you Expression Blend, which is our designer tool, and you can see the difference of what you could accomplish with one piece of code. Is there anything else I want to show you real quick? Okay, never mind. So, Visual Studio. After you go to this link, I'm going to show you one more link. bit.ly/wp7sdktools. Right, Windows Phone 7 SDK tools. All you need to do is click download the SDK, and it'll bring you to the SDK tools to be downloaded for free. It's going to be Visual Studio Express. It'll have everything that you'll pretty much need to get started. So everything's free, no sweat. Once you go there and install Visual Studio, I'm just going to go to New Project up here. And you see there's different templates under Visual C Sharp. You'll have Silverlight for Windows Phone, which I'm going to show you real quick. But you also see things like XNA Game Studio. So if you're writing a phone game, either phone game, game library for Xbox or Windows Phone or for the PC, this gives you access to that. So I'm just going to click on Silverlight for Windows Phone. Dean also showed you things like panorama, sort of this background picture while you're scrolling, as well as a pivot application. But let's go ahead and do a quick hello world with Windows Phone, and we'll show you what one line of code could do here versus the Expression Blend design tools. So I go ahead and just create this blank phone app, for example. And over here, you'll see the emulator on the left. I don't have much real estate, so I'm going to zoom out a bit. You have XAML code in the middle. So, and on the right, you'll sort of see this area where it's, the UI is such that you can modify the different elements, et cetera. So I'll kind of run through this quickly because I want to give time for Todd and Jim to do their really cool thing. So let's create our first Hello World or Hello E76 Windows app. Over here, you'll see all these different controls on the left. All I did was click on Toolbox on the bottom left over here, and I'm just going to drag a text block over. And you'll see that, as I drag and kind of change the size, you'll see the little red outlines. It tells me how large the pixels are. I'm going to name this my text block over here on the bottom right. Hit enter. And what's cool is, if I click on this element again, you can see that I can also change it through this properties box, right? Text is text block. Maybe I'll, just erase it, make it blank, and now you see on the emulator it is blank. Same thing here, height equals 48. Maybe let's make height equals 100. If I do a height equals 100, this changed to 100. But I can also change it in XAML, and I change it back to 80, right? And it changes to 80. I can do a search on the property of height, and it searches for everything height related. Actually, though, sorry, I got to click on that. And then height equals 80, right? So there's multiple ways for you to modify your code, either through the properties pane on the right, either through the XAML code, and you can visually see this on the emulator. What I'm going to do is I'm also going to add a button, right? I need to click something. So if I drag this button over here, as you can tell, my designer skills really are terrible, so I'm just kidding. We're all CS majors, right? So let's just make it this way. We'll have the designers do what they want. But if I click on button, same thing. I'm going to name this my button. I'm going to remove the search filter over here. And content automatically brings you to button. But if you also look on the XAML code, same thing. Content equals button. Let me just change it over here. Click me. Bang. Right, done. Click me, bang, and you don't see the bang because I'm not wide enough over here. So what's cool, you see these little snap to grids as well. So now we have a button, now we have a text block, and I'm going to create an event, a click event for ClickMe. Anyone know what to do to create an event handler over here? And I have some swag. What do I do? Anyone do Visual Studio? Double click it. All right. Let's see. I gave away a lot of my... All right, I'll find you guys later. But I have swag. I think I gave away in the first one. This is terrible. All right, so I double click on ClickMe, creates event handler. My button click, right? All I needed to do is double click. Now I'm going to create my text block dot text equals hello Harvard E76. Bam. Okay. I'm going to hit the play button so I can debug. And it loads up the emulator, compiles the code. The first time you run this, it takes 5-10 seconds or so. But everything afterwards take a couple of seconds to compile. So if you see here, let's let that load. All I need to do is click me, hello Harvard CS. Oh, well, it doesn't show up there because I didn't make my text block wide enough, right? So you see what this one line of code does from Visual Studio for Hello World. I'm going to kind of change it up and open up something called Expression Blend, which is our designer-related tool. So I'm going to stop debugging over here. I'm going to close this out. And let me see if I could find animations. Now, this piece of code, let me see if I got the right folder. Okay, blend, demo 2 animations. Okay, this piece of code is also part of the link I sent over here, the code samples. Okay, so if you want to refer to this, you can download the entire series with code samples and presentation. But what I'm going to show you here is something I also demoed at UPenn, and one of the students who happened to be an Android intern over the summer said that would have taken me 6 to 7 hours to actually code and make happen. And I'll show you what you could do in one line of code for 6 to 7 hours of Java if you really like it, if you're a really big fan.
So, you get paid by the hour.
This is very true. Oh my gosh. Thanks for messing that up for me. Okay, so what I'm going to do, right, if you double click on the solution file, the SLN file, what you'll see is Visual Studio opens up. But right click on the project, this flip card thing. And you'll see an option to open an expression blend. Again, expression blend is really more for designers. So, back a while ago, maybe you'll have someone do Photoshop, a designer, right? Artist, designer. And then they'll take their pictures or whatever their art is, and they'll, send it over to the CS folks who actually have to put pieces together and et cetera. But here, you'll see this really nice experience. So I clicked yes so I could sort of import all the code from Visual Studio. And you'll see the same thing over here. I don't have a lot of real estate, so let me zoom out and move this over. Okay. So same thing. You'll see the emulators in the middle. You'll see all your assets on the left side, and then you'll see what happens on the right side. What this does, I could have taken any two pictures and done this, but I'm going to create a game called Flipkard. And what will end up happening is, I'll show you the first part of it, but I'm going to take this card, I'm going to tap it, and it's going to rotate. So you can imagine all the vector, mathematical stuff that you have to do to make that happen in code. But with Expression Blend, I can do this in one line of code. Less code, very good for me. Okay, so I'm going to take this card. All I'm going to do is drag it. I'm going to actually make the margins to 0 so it fills up the entire space. Okay, so that's the back of the card, or actually the front of the card. Actually, I'll do it this way too. I'm going to do the same thing here. 0 on all the margins. I got to auto. Okay, here we go. Now, so I have two cards on top of each other. Right, and what I'm going to do for the other card, I'm going to hide this card, and I'm going to expand transform over here. And one of the cool things about transform is you could take this thing and kind of mess around with it, do all these cool transformations, again, without any code at all. So I'm going to undo that. I'm going to start this out as negative 90 degrees, so it's perpendicular to the user. And I'm going to take this object now. This is the card back image. And I'm going to create something called a storyboard. So I'm going to click plus over here for new storyboard. OK? Okay, I'm going to call this rotate card. Click OK. And what you'll see open up on the bottom left is this sort of timeline thing. I'm going to create this keyframe over here at time 0. So this is what happens at time 0. Now at time 1, I'm going to go ahead and move this to 90 degrees. Over here in the bottom right, I type 90. Okay. And what ends up happening? Well, now that card is rotated 90. And I'm going to maybe do that again for, I'm going to do time 2. What did I do over here? All right, I'm going to go back time 1. Sorry. Time 1, 90 degrees, done. Over here, I'm going to drag it to time 2, and I'm going to make it 180 degrees. Okay, so I'm going to click on this go to first frame, right, and I'm going to play. I'm going to see what this timeline looks like. Right, so now the card rotated entire 180 degrees. What I can do too is create, if I click on this little keyframe icon over here, I can do something called easing functions, right? So that was kind of boring. It kind of just, you know, rotated on its axis kind of slowly. Maybe I want to add some flair to it. So let's do something like, I don't know, Quintic. That sounds interesting. So if I click on Quintic, let me hit play again. Right, sort of quick, fast, and slow. Let me do a different easing function over here, maybe elastic. Right, and you can define a number of oscillations and springiness. I'm not coding here so far, as you see. I'm going to click on go to first frame. I'm going to click play. There you go. Right, now, the next thing is, how do I actually get an event to be created so I can tap this card? Well, I'm going to click on events up here in the top right, and I'm going to see the tap event. I'm going to double click on tap event, and I'm going to type in this dot rotate card dot begin. Bam, one line of code. Okay, I'm going to go to project, and I'm going to run it. Okay, it's going to compile, and all I have to do is tap the card and done. You can publish your app, $100 right there, $99. You guys buy it, right? So, but what you can see is, as a designer, right, I just needed maybe one line of code, or I can even just port it back to my my coder, right? I can just go to right-click on flip card up here on the top left. I can edit this now in Visual Studio. And now I have my updated code over here. Okay, so all this with one line of code using a mix of Visual Studio and Expression Blend. Is that kind of cool? Right, imagine trying to manually do that in Java or, you know, Objective-C or something, right? So anyway, hopefully that kind of got you really interested in the tools. Go to those links, check out all the different video series. They actually do a lot more cool stuff in Expression Blend. If you have any questions, I'll write my email address down here. But I'm going to hand it over to Todd Mancini, who is going to go through sort of more of the tools and stuff. So thank you very much, and I'll pass it on to Todd.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Todd Mancini. My title's not as long as Edwin's, but it might be cooler. I'm the United States Chief Technology Evangelist for Developer Tools, so I'm kind of the guy that covers all of our developer tools. I have nationwide coverage for that, but I am actually based here in Massachusetts. And I actually attended the Harvard Extension School when I was pursuing a physics degree. That was in the 80s, however, so that was a very long time ago. So I'm going to actually dive into some additional development. Edwin got us started with a great look at it. I'm going to actually be using the free version of the developer tools. And the nice thing about our developer tools is they're fairly lightweight. As you can see, there was the emulator. The emulator works really well. It runs on a bevy of devices, which is nice. To that point, when I show it today, I will actually be doing my development on a Slate device that's running Windows 8, and which I just realized the battery is about to die on. So I'm going to find a plug for it in this sea of cables and plug it in. And what I'm going to do is, first let me ask, so from a development standpoint, are people mainly, they've done iOS development in the room, show of hands, done some iOS development? Done Android development. Okay, about half and half there. And who has done .NET development of any kind? Oh, well, see, now that's good to see, because the .NET development actually was the largest number, show of hands. And why that's good is, and as Edwin was kind of showing you, that's all going to play well. Because, you know, .NET is certainly a development model you can use on the phone. And we all, there was also a question, hey, if I write it for a particular device, will it run on any device? Absolutely. Here I'm going to be using this Samsung device. I have a bunch of devices at home, although I don't yet have a Nokia device. I'm waiting to get one of those. But I'm due off contract, or to renew my contract in 1 month, so I'm very excited to get one. And actually, in preparation for this, I found the earliest cell phone in my house I could find, which is a Nokia one. I plugged it into the power to charge it, turned it on, and it actually turned on. The thing is utterly indestructible, so I do like those. So I'm logging into my little Slate device over here, or trying to. And one more try, and I'll switch over to the keyboard. It's really not liking me. Toot, toot, toot. There we go. All right. So that's the picture password, just one way of logging in. And I've got my little Bluetooth keyboard here, which I will turn on. So this is my actual Windows 8 device. Once again, I should be careful, not sure what will pop up. But under Windows 8, you get the kind of same experience that you get on Windows Phone, this notion of these live tiles. They're constantly updating with real-time information. So you don't even necessarily have to go in to an app. And the other thing that I thought was interesting, and I'll go over to my regular desktop here, was that Edwin, when he was kind of showing the integration there, said, look, I get all my friends from Facebook, and all the pictures come from Facebook. And it's like, the integration, just to be clear, is far deeper than Facebook. I'm not so much a Facebook person. I use LinkedIn and Twitter and those more often. Those all have a deep level of integration. And now the great part of that story is, and the same is true for you, and that's the first thing you got to understand when you start looking at Windows Phone development, is you really got to kind of think different. Are we allowed to say that? We don't own that, so I won't say that. You got to think differently, though, about what it means to write a mobile app. Because you don't want to think in a world where, oh, I'm going to have my app, and it's going to be, someone's going to click on this rectangular icon somewhere and magically get into my application and hope they like it. You really do want to start thinking about these integration points. You know, if you're going to write an app that's centered around music, and hopefully, let me go to the document camera. So first thing we notice is we are supposed to be in this lecture, so we are, so that's good. There's my start screen, and nope, you're going to have to wait a second while I type in my password. So there you can see. So I haven't touched this phone in an hour and a half. I have 73 new work emails and 3 new personal emails on Hotmail. So that's not a good sign. But so when you go in here, when you start talking about like things like music, which unfortunately I'm connected to my laptop right now, so it's going to not show those. Let me just unplug that. You can actually have your applications start to integrate into the music area because they are music related. If you have picture related apps, imagine you make an app that's all about, hey, someone takes a photograph and now I want them to be able to augment that photograph, do funky things to it, recolor it, whatever. You're gonna want to have your app exist in that Photos hub, and so on and so forth. So you really need to start thinking more about the functionality and how you want that to interact with the rest of the operating system rather than just making your standalone app. The benefit of that is you will end up having much more discoverable applications. They're not just lost in the sea of tiles, but they're really available to the end user to interact with in the context that they're in. And the last thing before we get into the code, there are multiple ways of doing development on Windows Phone. There's the Silverlight model and the XNA model, the two predominant ones that most people have access to. I'll talk briefly about XNA, just because people are sometimes interested in it. If you're going to do like real game development that's really high speed, in particular, you need to have access to 3D. then you kind of got to go the XNA route. That's where that exists. And that's kind of low-level 3D libraries for doing true 3D direct X9 type manipulations. But the good news is you're still coding in C#. I've written games in XNA, so here's an app that I published that's written in XNA. Let's see if it works. Hey, it does. So, and I'm not very good at it, I'll admit. But you can, nice graphics, lots of sprites. If you go to the high level on this game, I think the highest I've ever seen was about 500 different sprites going simultaneously on the screen, somewhere in that ballpark. So you can really start to exercising the system pretty deeply. If you're really just talking about a simpler game or just apps, Silverlight's the model, so I'll probably stick with Silverlight tonight. It's just a little bit easier for people to wrap their heads around. And I had one other thing to say about that. Oh, and the other cool thing about Silverlight is it does have an enormous amount of libraries available for it and things called behaviors. So Edwin went and he showed you doing a storyboard. Now, what was really cool is he went into the XAML, and the XAML is essentially a markup language that describes your page. Think of it like HTML for applications. You would have seen that storyboard that he had done graphically in the editor actually being persisted out just as XML data that says, hey, here's how we rotate and manipulate that card when we flip it. So, you know, there's no, like, magic code library running behind the scenes. It's just the XAML presentation layer. But there are other libraries and behaviors out there that you can get and apply to your object. So if you wanted to create the next Angry Birds-like game, there's actually a whole physics library you can get that's freely available, very popular out there, that you can then just add it to an object in Silverlight, and now you just flick the object on the screen and it starts bouncing around and you decide how gravity works and all that jazz. So you can be very productive very, very quickly. All right, so back to my my laptop here, and I'll do something about that font with my pen. We mentioned, hey, if you get three apps published, you can get a free phone. And you might think, well, that sounds like a chicken and the egg problem. How am I going to write an app and get it published if I don't have a phone? The emulator on our platform, I will argue, is the best phone emulator on any platform from a development standpoint. It's incredibly fluid. Incredibly responsive, runs great on even fairly old hardware. Most of my demos I used to do before I moved to this slate was on this old Acer. It's, 5 years old, 4 or 5 years old. And it runs XNA, Silverlight, and the emulator absolutely perfectly fine. So, you know, if people don't believe me, I'll show you that later. But that emulator is full-featured. The app that I just showed you, that game that I just showed you, that I got published in the marketplace, was published on launch day when the phones were launched in the U.S. As Microsoft employees, so there would be enough phones for people to buy, we weren't allowed to buy phones until a week after launch day. That app was created, debugged, tested, and published without ever having actually been on a physical phone. The first person that bought that app and played it on a phone was not me, it was somebody else. I don't know who it was. Well, I know what their high score was, and I know what their gamer tag was, but that's about all I know about them. You can get very far just using the freely available tools in emulator. So let me show you this app here. We'll look at it first, so you can see what it is. I'll just hit the old debug button. And so it's got this little splash screen, and essentially this is a little Harvard app that I've created. And I'll admit I cheated. We do have a bunch of toolkits out there available that make it fairly easy for you to kind of start with a template and expand onto that. So here I've got like an RSS feed, some contact information. Some of this is real, some of this is fake. Here's a map. I click on that. Here's Bing Maps. It shows, you know, Harvard Hall, and it's loading over Wi-Fi right now. Here is the Northwest Science Labs where we are. So that's on the map there. And oops, went too far. And I just stopped debugging the app, so I'll hit play again. And then the last thing was it was also pulling in weather data somewhere over here. 80 degrees and 63 tomorrow. Although that says tomorrow's Monday, so I don't know what that. Oh, maybe that's saying today. Today was 63 to 91. It's currently 80 degrees. A lot of times when you start writing apps, you're going to think about consuming data and consuming services. And we make that really easy in Windows Phone. There's a lot of capabilities in Windows Phone to drive home data-driven apps, especially from remote services. They don't have to do it that way, but that's how you do it. So here I go into my file here. And what this is basically using a development model called MVVM, Model View View Model. Anyone familiar with MVVM? Just a couple people. So this is a very common design paradigm that you're going to see over and over again from a lot of Microsoft things and, quite frankly, on a lot of other platforms as well. And the idea here is this. You've got a model, a view, and a view model, right? Model, view, view model, MVVM. And it's really about separation of concerns. So it's a way of approaching software development such that I'm going to keep my modeling of the data that I'm passing back and forth between these disparate systems, you know, separate from how I present that data. So the view is really essentially what is displaying that data onto the screen. And then the view model is really the translation between the two. How do I take the data from the model, which comes in some format, might be a binary format, some XML format, what have you, but it's got its own data types and everything. Those may or may not be directly compatible with the view that I have, so I need some way of basically translating between the data that comes in and the presentation on screen. What's nice about MVVM and other patterns like it is that code becomes highly reusable. So there are a lot of MVVM apps out there that have been written on Windows Phone that are resurfacing now in Windows 8's preview, because all you essentially have to do is change the view and perhaps the view model a little bit to say, all right, here's how you display this app in Windows 8. And that's a great part of our platform story, actually, is around the notion that, hey, what does it take to make these new style Windows 8 apps? Well, they can be written in a number of ways, but one way is essentially using .NET and XAML. XAML for your presentation UI and .NET essentially for the code, which sounds an awful lot like the Silverlight development model on the phone, and indeed they are very similar. So your skills will continue to translate forward even if you start looking beyond just Windows Phone, but potentially Windows 8 as an ecosystem as well. So before I go any further, any questions so far? Please.
Silverlight guy in the browser.
Yeah.
And it seems Prism would be a little heavy to use on the phone.
So Prism has definitely been used on the phone. Please. Oh, I'm sorry. So the question was, what about model view view model on the phone? There's another abstraction version of that called Prism. It's a framework that's available out there. About using isolation containers, what have you. And so Prism, which is a fairly large framework that you can get out there, it's freely available. It's from the Microsoft Patterns and Practices group. Would that be appropriate for the phone, essentially? The answer is, yeah, I do actually have customers that use Prism on the phone. It is big, right? But you got to be a little bit cautious about how you approach it, but it does give you some great reuse. So you can do Prism on the phone.
Is Silverlight 3 solid for the phone? Because, like I said, I was one of the guys pretty disappointed that Silverlight 5 is the last release, really, for the browser. And so is the same thing going to happen with the phone?
So I know nothing about the future direction of Silverlight. So the question was Silverlight 5, is that the last version? And it's apparently the last one in the browser, you seem to be suggesting. You haven't heard that from me or anyone else. And what's the future of Silverlight on the phone? So the development model for the phone right now is Silverlight and XNA. We've not said that that's changing anytime too soon. But you'll probably be one of the first ones to know if and when we make any announcements in that space. We haven't said anything there. But like I tried to allude to, .NET and XAML are definitely first-class programming paradigms on the Microsoft platform going forward. Now, whether or not they are called Silverlight may be more a marketing issue than anything else, quite frankly, right? So I would say don't be fearful of having this investment in .NET and XAML and thinking that's going away, or investments in MVVM or Prism, what have you. They're all the right things to learn. All right, so what does this application look like? You know, how does one go about putting together this app that seems, you know, it's pretty rich and pretty detailed? And the reality is it's actually fairly simple. There's very few pages inside this application. This application is predominantly content, right? It's the graphic files and what have you. We did an analysis of most of the games in the on the phone marketplace, and I think if you look at all of them and average it out, if you download a game, let's say the game is 20 meg or 30 meg, whatever it may be, about somewhere between about 0.8 and 1.8% of that download is code. The remaining 98 odd percent is content, music, graphics, what have you. So, I guess if you have any friends that can draw, be good friends with them, because that's really key to having great success in this. It doesn't take much code to do a lot. In a XAML-based world, Silverlight-based world, XAML-based world here, it is essentially dealing with pages. So you can quite honestly think a lot about what it means to put together a web-based application. If you have that mental model, you'll probably have reasonably good luck here. So I'm just going to, just for the sake of the screen resolution here, I'm just going to close some of these windows that we don't need right now. So as Edwin was showing you, you've got this kind of preview window going on over there that's complaining about an error message, and my mouse isn't working, essentially close to a live preview. So as I change the graphics in this application, you'll see that little display change there. If you do a really good job and you get really good controls, the really smart ones, actually, instead of where it says here, like loading news, it would actually display dummy news data. So you can actually have controls that actually have populated with them sample data. So even if you don't have a connection, they can show you something in this at this design time. Expression Blend makes it incredibly easy, actually, for you to add that type of sample data to a control. So oftentimes when I'm doing my development, I bounce back and forth between Visual Studio and Expression Blend. But if we go look at the actual XAML here, this is where the bulk of it happens, right? There's not nearly as much code here as one might expect. So I've got my XAML file, and behind that I have what's called a code behind file, which is that mainpage.xaml.cs. That's the C# file that has the code behind this main page. But let's start with the XAML first. It starts off with a very, I'll make the font a little bit bigger there. It starts with a very large, maybe that's too big. And let's just move that sucker out of the way. Oh, I didn't want to swap them. Okay, great. There, that's a little bit better right there. So here we have this large decoration block at the top. This is not doing much other than predominantly setting up namespaces and things like that, so much like you would see like in an XML document. So a bunch of namespaces being set up here just so it's less verbose when we get further down there. And this is a phone application page, meaning this is a page of my application as would be presented on the phone, and it's really this page-based model. And a page can be a fairly large thing. That panorama view where it shows you can kind of just scroll left and right and shows you, hey, here are the current events, news feeds, map. That's all really kind of part of one page. So there's a couple of things set up here, including design data. So this is what I was kind of mentioning before. Some parts of that page, as I navigate around it, even when I'm just in Visual Studio as an editor, will have sample data showing up in it. And that is essentially pulled from this design data document that you can then pop seed with any data as appropriate. On a Windows Phone app, you can indicate what types of orientations your application can support. There's portrait and landscape. And I might say, well, my app doesn't work in landscape mode. And what that basically tells the system is if someone tilts their phone horizontally, don't rotate the screen. So if I turn my phone on like the start page here doesn't have a landscape mode. So when I turn it sideways, nothing happens. But if I hold it straight up, you know, there it is. So that's what I'm basically saying here is the supported orientations are just portrait, and the initial orientation would be portrait. But I could say, hey, it supports both portrait and landscape, but assume start in portrait first or assume start in landscape first, so on and so forth. And then some issues here, things here about, hey, do I have access to the information on the top of the screen that has like the battery indicator? Do I want that to display or not? And also, how do I want menus integrated? Some of that stuff is in here as well. And then down below, we essentially have a bunch of templates. And a template is really an expression of, hey, I've got some data that's going to repeat over and over again. So imagine like an RSS feed, right? It's going to have a title and then maybe a little abstract, what have you. I want that to be clickable. And with the template, you essentially set that up once. Say, each item that comes from this RSS feed, I want to be rendered this way. And then the template says, all right, now I'll just ad nauseum iterate over that data. So where in another programming model, you might be thinking about writing for each loops and doing printfs or however else you might be getting things onto the screen. Here, you rarely ever think about that. You really think more about how you're going to present it, what is the shape of that, and you do that in XAML. And then somewhere else, we will do the data binding that says, hey, take the data in from this remote feed, whatever that feed may be. It could be just a local file, it could be a remote service, and basically you tell the framework, now go make it display, and you don't have to do any work there. So what you see down below here is just all these templates that I set up. So there's canvases. So canvas is, you know, it's a canvas, it's like a 2D bitmap, right? So it lets you draw images. You know, stack panels are a way of arranging multiple other visual objects in a particular way, a horizontal or vertical stack. And inside that stack panel there, you see I've got three text blocks. And as you can see, these text blocks eventually get bound down to some data. So this one is bound to the name. So this data feed comes in. Imagine it's a JSON feed or something like that. And it has properties in it. So it has like a name property, it has an email property, and a phone number property. And that's how simple it is for me to take that data from that feed and map it to the way I want to lay it on the screen. I don't have to really do any of that mapping necessarily myself. If I want to, you know, display the phone number first and the email number second, I could just, you know, just move those, right? You know, it's as simple as that. You know, it's and we worked really hard to make the easy stuff super simple and even the hard stuff reasonably approachable, right? And that's our development model. And that's always been a key tenet of .NET anyway. And it's obviously something that is motivated the design of XAML as well. So then we got some other ones. Here's where the news comes in. And you know, it's got some border around it. It also has a text box, so on and so forth. Here are some links and the weather data. So, you know, this just goes on and on and on. And with essentially very little code, and in this case, no code so far, we haven't looked at the code yet, I can create this whole display of all this rich data. Here I have a storyboard. So Edwin showed you making the storyboard using Blend. Here's what it looks like when Blend is done with it. It basically spits out more XAML that, quite frankly, is fairly easy to read. So you've got some easing function here that says, hey, go from this keyframe to this keyframe to this keyframe. And you know, this one's at time 0, time half a second, time 0.9 seconds, and some value that is oscillating at that time. And then that value gets applied to something. And in this case, it's getting applied to the X rotation of some element in my user interface. So this is basically how that animation got bound here. So if I didn't want to go back into Blend, you know, let's say I felt that the animation was too quick, right, and I wanted to make it a little bit longer, I could go, you know, 1.1. And I just made it last 0.2 seconds longer, right? I don't have to go back into Blend to do that. If I do go back into Blend, I'm not going to freak Blend out. Blend will reparse this file just fine. I mean, you know, it's not like it's a one-way wizard, which if you've been coding as long as I have been, there were as many one-way wizards back in the day, but not anymore. And then lastly, buttons. And this is probably the last most important thing I'll talk about on the XAML side of things. When you look at user interface elements in Silverlight, really in XAML, this is a XAML thing, not so much a Silverlight thing, you've got to start to separate the notion of behavior from presentation. So let's talk about a button. Now, everyone thinks they know what a button is, right? It's that thing that's on the screen. You click it, and then something happens when you click it. There are different kinds of buttons. Some are state-changing, like you click it, and it's on. You click it again, and it's off, so on and so forth. There's behaviors, the notion that it's clickable. It's a clickable thing, right? That has nothing to do with the way it's on screen. Because if you think about it, a button on Windows Phone, they tend to be very plain rectangles. Because Windows Phone has this notion, it's born digital, right? You go for a very simple Metro UI, don't do a lot of annotation and decoration around these objects because it just distracts the user. As we like to say, it's Chromeless. I love saying that. No Chrome, right? So there's a subtle geek joke in there somewhere. But in XAML, a button, actually, if you create a button in XAML, nothing will display on screen. And the reason for that is a button doesn't actually have any display characteristics whatsoever. A button is merely a behavior. And something that is a button is clickable and has a few other little properties associated with it. But essentially, a button is a clickable thing. And when you click it, it generates a on-clicked event. And that's really all a button is. So you're like, well, then what are those things I see that I know to be buttons? And that comes down to the visual component. So when you look at this button here, which I've lost somewhere up here, there was a button. I'm using a control template to target my buttons. So the way a button appears is actually controlled by different parts of your XAML. So a button has no inherent display characteristics. So this lets you do a couple of interesting things. First of all, you can make your buttons look whatever you want them to look like, right? If you want your buttons to look the exact same way they look on a Mac or an iPhone or on Android or any other device, you could. Matter of fact, that style that you apply to a button, you can actually kind of control globally to your application because you can just say to your app, hey, every time there's a button, display it this way. You kind of design it once and you're off to the races. Designers love this because as a developer, we can go and just put buttons down and we might be just using regular plain old ugly buttons and the designer might say, no, we have a really particular look that we're going to use for buttons in this application, and they set that once essentially in a style sheet, what it looks like, very similar to a style sheet, but for XAML, and they now can change the way the buttons look in the entire application. Take that a step further. The reason why a button displays anything is because it's what's called a content presenter. It is something that can present content on screen. It can draw itself, if you will. Well, what can you put inside of presentable content? The answer is anything. It's the visual root of any visual tree that you can imagine. So if in your world you think a button should have a nice rounded purple border, have a video animation of flames inside, and then an array of 1 billion checkboxes in it. And each one of those checkboxes, oh, by the way, should have some animation that's spinning around in, you know, semi 2.5D or something like that. Go ahead. That'll be a button, right? You can easily take a button and just put that in it. Now, maybe not the billion checkboxes. You probably run out of memory, but you get the idea. So, it gives you an incredible amount of power. With great power comes great responsibility, though, so don't abuse it. You know, let's put it this way. If you're like me and you're an engineer, you love the fact that you can do this until your wife looks at the app you've written and is like, what on earth have you done? It's just a nightmare. So So you'll see some of that in here. You'll see that there's places where we're stylizing our content. But we do it for a good reason. So we only have to kind of do it once, and it visually repeats throughout the app. And I think that's about it for this page. So let's go look at the code so we can see what if there's actually any real code in here. And there is. So this one is not as good as Edwin's. It's not done in a single line of code. But I said, like I said before, the Java developers are better if they get paid by the hour because they have to take longer. And if I get paid by lines of code, I'm still making more money than you. So we go in here. So the first thing you notice is, wow, this looks a lot like a regular .NET program. And the reason why it does is because it is. I mean, at the end of the day, a .NET is .NET, classes are classes, all the kind of things that you're used to seeing in a Microsoft development world still apply in this world. So you've got a main page, and yes, there are, there's one that you've said, hey, that's one where the application is going to start. You know, it wouldn't be a Microsoft program if it didn't have something called initialized component in it. That is basically where when the wizard of Visual Studio is writing code for you, it typically sticks all of its code inside of that method. And then we basically got event handlers. It's like on Navigated 2. So on Navigated 2 is an event that fires when this page is navigated to. So think about it. I've got a web page. I want to do something when that web page loads. Well, this is very similar to that. That's saying, hey, someone just navigated to this page of your application. Do you want to do anything about that? And naturally, this happens when you launch the app because you're navigating to the front page of the app. So you can, in this case, set up your data context. And this is where we're essentially taking all of the data that we're pulling in from these remote services, the weather feed and the RSS feeds and what have you. And we're taking that from our view model, and we're attaching it to the data context for this page. And the data context is a kind of just a special object in this page that then is what all that data binding that I showed you a few minutes ago it then feeds off of. So that one line of code essentially causes every piece of data in this application to draw itself. And we'll get into the view model in a moment. And then lastly, we got to do a little extra work to set up the map image, because the map image itself, we have to go grab that from Bing's map service. So we just have another little method there. Then the other thing that you'll see that's very near the top of this code is this on back key press. If you have a Windows phone, there aren't that many buttons on them. There's the same buttons pretty much on all of them. And kind of by law, if you will, right? Can we say that? So we mandate five buttons on these phones. Five. Power button, I guess you need to have that, right? A dedicated camera button. So every Windows phone, this one is locked. I just took out of my, off the table. I hold down the camera button, and I just took a picture, right? So very quick to use it just as a regular camera. And if you don't have a phone with a dedicated camera button and you have and then you get to play with one of these, you'll find it very hard to go back with a phone that doesn't have a dedicated camera button. It's probably my favorite feature of the phone, quite honestly. I use that heavily. And then we've got the three buttons essentially on the bottom, which can be real hardware buttons or just capacitive touch buttons. These are capacitive on this particular Samsung device. And that's a... let me just go into something here. That's a Windows button, which brings me home, right? If I hold it down, open settings. It goes into voice command mode. And it's not hearing me in this room. And then a search button, which always brings me to a Bing search application. And a back button. Now, the good news is, although these five buttons are there, you have to care about almost none of them. Camera button, that takes a picture. So your app doesn't respond to that. The power button turns the phone on and off. So your app doesn't necessarily respond to that, although you may want to do data serialization, other things when your app goes to sleep. We'll talk about that. Search does Bing search. You don't do anything there. But this back button is important. This back button is the one that you do need to respond to in some intelligent way, and quite honestly, it's probably the part of the phone where we have the most rules for app developers that say, hey, the back button should have the following behaviors. And there's a long list of rules around that. But, you know, to sum it up, the back button should do what a normal user would expect it to do. Right? It acts sort of like when you're in a web browser. If I'm in your app and I go from page A to page B to page C, and I hit the back button, I expect to go back to page B. So A to B to C, back to B, hit it again, back to A, hit it again, out of your app. Right? And that's essentially what the back button should do. And here, we're just doing a little bit extra where we're looking to see if certain things have been visible or not. How do we want to reestablish the visibility of certain artifacts on screen? But when you use the kind of the tools and the frameworks that we ship you these days, you don't have to write a lot of code for this. The kind of built-in behaviors do the right things automatically, in a sense. So this is just getting that image from Bing, so nothing interesting there. And then some things around the navigation service. So the navigation service is probably the next most important thing to understand. So there's a link list box selection changed event. So I have some list box that is full of links. And if the selection on that changes, this event gets fired. And you know, you can essentially think about this as, hey, what if I go and I touch one of those links, I interact with it. So I selected one of the links in that. What should I do? And what we do is if the link is an RSS link, we navigate somewhere. And if you think about it in a web-based app, you navigate to some URL, or for those of you that want to be completely RFC compliant, you're actually technically navigating to some URI, which URLs are a subset of all the universe of URIs. And that's usually to some well-defined URL somewhere. And in this case, I can actually navigate to feedpage.xaml, which is another page compiled into my application. So if you look over here, up in this area over here, and don't try to move things when you do that, there's that feedpage.xaml. So basically what it's saying is, hey, if you click on an RSS link, we've got a whole nother page that we're going to use to render that content for. And you can even pass parameters in, and it looks just like a regular query string, right? We didn't really reinvent the wheel for most of this stuff. It looks and behaves very similar to many other technologies you've probably used over and over and over again. And because I'm using this object here, the navigation service, that whole rigmarole that I went through about 4 minutes ago around the back button, that's why you don't have to worry about it. This object here, this navigation service, does it all for you. Now, the navigation service wasn't part of Windows Phone when it shipped. It comes as part of some of the additional toolkits, and it's very useful. It makes life a lot better. Edwin had briefly mentioned something called the Silverlight Toolkit. I highly recommend it. It essentially is we've created a whole bunch of new controls, additional controls. There's the Silverlight Toolkit, both for just like regular Silverlight running in the browser, but then a release specifically for Windows Phone. I think the last update was just this past December. And it gives you all sorts of these additional little controls and gadgets that make your life easier. Some of them run faster than the original ones we shipped with the phone, so on and so forth. So definitely look into that. You said you had a link for that in your smart links there. Good.
Check out the bit.ly link.
And then the last thing here that is, I think, pretty cool is this web browser task. And it's not cool because it's a web browser task, but it's really one of many services available in the phone called tasks. So the other important aspect of a Windows Phone application, what makes them so rich and so user-friendly, is through these tasks. And what tasks are essentially the low-level operating system features that are exposed to you as an app developer. And I really shouldn't call them low-level. They're really actually fairly high-level operating system features. So, for example, if you need someone in your app to have an interaction with someone from their contact list. Okay. You can do the contact chooser task, I think is what it's called, something along those lines. And with that one line of code, your phone will now present to them all of their contacts. Where that contact list that gets presented to them is highly dependent upon their world. So my contact list includes people from Facebook, includes people from my Exchange server from Microsoft. I also run my own Exchange server out of my house. It pulls it from there. I have Hotmail. It pulls all my contacts from my Hotmail account, from my Gmail account, from LinkedIn, from all these services that tightly integrate in the phone. I, as an app developer, think nothing about that. I don't even worry about that. I just know, hey, the person wants to be able to choose a contact, and they're going to get one unified view of all the contacts. If, you know, 2 months from now, a new update comes on the phone that includes contacts from some other endpoint, you as an app developer don't even worry about that. You're going to get them automatically and for free. In this case, I'm just firing up the web browser, and I get to now have a web browser integrated into my application. I get the full richness of IE9 on Windows Phone, which is a very nice, very fast HTML5-based web browser. So with that, I want to give Jim his time. So I'm going to stop there, just give you a little bit of flavor of what development is like on Windows Phone. And Jim's going to continue from where I left off with some other interesting ideas. But I welcome questions. You know, maybe at the end we'll do some Q&A time. So Jim.
So let me bring up the rear here. In about the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to give you an overview of where the cloud fits into building Windows Phone applications, and actually any kind of mobile application when we go to Windows 8 as well. This will all be quite relevant. My name is Jim O'Neill. I'm a developer evangelist with Microsoft. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of words in my title, but I'm working on it. I'm open to suggestions if you have some. Contact information at the bottom, and Edwin certainly would know how to get a hold of me as well if you have additional questions as we go through this. So I want to pose the question, why use the cloud for mobile applications? And Todd actually brought this up with probably out even knowing it, when he talked about applications being interactive. Think about it. Words for Friends is successful because it's Words for Friends, Words with Friends. It wouldn't be successful if it was Words all by myself, right? You need something in the back to connect you to the rest of the world to make these applications engaging. So that concept of social interactivity is very, very important to a successful mobile game, and there's got to be some plumbing there. The cloud offers that plumbing. Another reason the cloud is a big factor in mobile applications is time to market. You have a really, really cool idea. You want to get it out there very, very quickly before somebody else does. How do you do that? Do you go and you buy servers and you set them up and you set up all this infrastructure and you start installing software? No, you go to Amazon or you go to Windows Azure and you pull out your credit card and you buy a couple of virtual machines and you get them up and running in about 10 minutes. And you've got your application ready to go then and there. And then lastly, is relatively inexpensive. Now this can change depending on how successful your application is. If you look at Zynga, for instance, they've gone to the cloud and back again, because they have so much of an infrastructure and they have so much of a load that's actually cheaper for them to host everything themselves. But for most of us that are just building games, we want to get them out there quickly and sort of test the waters and hope to be very successful. It's the quickest, fastest, cheapest way to get there. And actually for you, it's free. We have a number of different offers that you can get a hold of to get some time in the cloud, relatively enough to run a website 24/7. Get your feet wet, figure out what the cloud services are, and so on. So I invite you to go to that link and get your free account with Windows Azure and start trying out some of the stuff I'm going to chat about briefly. So why else would you want the cloud? Well, we all hear about the cloud in terms of scaling, large applications like Twitter and Facebook, and that's really true. But it's also there for scaling smaller applications. If your Windows Phone application, for instance, is connected to the shopping season, well, you might expect to get a lot of traffic near Christmas or Mother's Day or various holidays, and maybe not so much in the downtimes. How do you handle that? Do you pay for servers? Do you pay for infrastructure to handle the worst case 24/7? Probably not. You're going to lose money. Going to the cloud allows you to do something called bursting and allows me to spin up additional resources when I'm going to have the demand on my application. So let me talk a little bit about Windows Azure in general to give you a level set on when I talk about the cloud. What does that mean in terms of Microsoft technology, Microsoft parlance? And then I'll show you a few examples of some Windows Phone applications that were built with Windows Azure at the back end. So when we talk about cloud computing in general, there's a bunch of different buckets that people will associate various cloud vendors in. Windows Azure is part of the public cloud. Amazon's part of the public cloud. Google App Engine's part of the public cloud. A lot of enterprises are setting up private clouds using technology like OpenStack because they don't want to essentially have all of their stuff, their data, and their intellectual property hosted in a provider like Microsoft, like Google, somebody that they're not absolutely in control of. And then there's other buckets that talk about what types of cloud applications they are. Are they applications you buy, like Salesforce.com? You pay a monthly fee and you access the application over the web and you don't really care how it's built. Or are you actually building applications? Are you building applications from the infrastructure level when you might use Amazon EC2 and buy virtual machines and outfit those virtual machines and put your code on them? Or are you using it at a higher level abstraction called platform as a service, where you're essentially just building an application and you're saying, okay, deploy this to the cloud. So that's what Google does. That's what Windows Azure does. And Windows Azure essentially fits in that sweet spot of public cloud and platform as a service. So that's sort of the high level place of where Windows Azure fits in the ecosystem. We drive down a little bit. The cloud is somewhere. It's not up in the sky. It's actually data centers that reside somewhere. We actually have 8 data centers. 2 of them just came online last week. 2 additional ones in the US, the East and the West Coast. And then we have the North and South Central US, and then 2 in Europe and 2 in the Far East. These are essentially autonomous data centers. They all run the same infrastructure, but once your data and your application is residing in one of these places, it doesn't leave there. Okay? If you want it to have a global presence, you may decide to deploy your application in multiple different data centers to meet the load and the end users that are in your various geographies. Inside the data centers, they look something like this, just a warehouse floor with tractor-trailer rigs that get backed up into it. Inside each rig is essentially 1,800 to 2,000 servers. These are commodity servers. And by commodity, what I mean is it's a machine that you could probably buy from Dell or HP with a couple grand. It's not a 256-core supercomputer. It's just a bunch of smaller 8-core machines with disk and with, you know, motherboards and so on that just reside in these tractor-trailer rigs. If something fails, not a big deal in the cloud because there's so many of them, and there's actually a controlling application that sits on top of it called the Fabric Controller in Windows Azure, in the Windows Azure Cloud. The Fabric Controller is sort of the brains of the data center, knows exactly what's running on every one of those machines. So if your application, maybe it's a website or a web service, is sitting on one of those blades and it goes down for whatever reason, the Fabric Controller will know that and will start it up somewhere else in the data center. Nobody gets called at 3 a.m. It just all happens. Okay. At some point, if enough of those things go down and they need to actually repair the container, they'll just ship it out and bring another one back in. And then as we've evolved the data center technology, we're actually to the point now where we're deploying these other units that look very much like the ones inside, except they're designed to sit outside. So we don't even need the infrastructure of the building around it anymore, because those units are designed to use essentially the ambient air conditions and things like adiabatic cooling. There's actually a garden hose in here, too, to provide additional cooling so that they can reside in climates where there's not a lot of temperature extremes. Dublin, Ireland, for instance, is the site of one of our data centers, and we can use those units there. So very, very low cost in terms of energy, and sort of the whole green IT initiative is being rolled into these data centers as well. Okay. So we went from global to a local data center, and now let's talk a little bit about what you do with Windows Azure. So you're going to write some applications. You've got a Windows Phone application that is a game and needs a leaderboard. Or you need to pull down data for the app that that Todd was showing you, the information from the maps, or maybe information very germane to Harvard University, list of course schedules or something along those lines. You've got to host that data somewhere. When you host applications in Windows Azure, you're hosting what we call compute instances. So a compute instance, think of it as like a web service or a website. Okay? It's essentially, if you're an ASP.NET developer, an ASP.NET website or WCF web service, if you're a PHP developer, it's just a PHP website, that you're hosting inside of a virtual machine that Windows Azure Fabric Controller is taking care of for you. So the experience to you as a developer, and I'll show you a little bit of this inside of Visual Studio, is building an ASP.NET web page or website and then saying, I want to right-click, deploy this to the cloud. And when you deploy it to the cloud, you say, I want to go to the North Central Data Center, I want to run a couple of copies of this, and it just happens for you. That's the platform as a service aspect of Windows Azure. You're just saying, my application, here it is, go run it. You're not building virtual machines. You're not outfitting infrastructure or anything like that when you're dealing with Windows Azure. So that's the compute aspect of things, websites, web services. The storage, jump ahead here. The storage aspect, there's really two blocks of storage. There's one where we talk about very highly scalable Twitter, Facebook type scale data storage, where you need very high throughput. You need to be able to store terabytes and terabytes of data, the whole big data explosion. That's where our Windows Azure storage fits in. And Windows Azure storage has like three different flavors. The first flavor is just unstructured data. So think about blobs, think about Word documents or MP3 files. Think about Dropbox, for instance, Amazon's simple storage service, just a place to put stuff. Windows Azure allows you to do that. Windows Azure also has a NoSQL brand of storage. So NoSQL is becoming more and more popular as a semi-structured data storage option that doesn't come with some of the relational semantic overhead like ACID transactions and relational calculus and those types of things. So it's being used by a lot of these larger companies to get the scale that they need. Things like MongoDB, Redis, and so on fit into this category. So Windows Azure's version of that type of storage is called just Windows Azure Tables. Rather benign vanilla naming, unfortunately. And then the last one is storage for messaging. So if you've got a lot of different services that are on the cloud working together with clients, you can't expect them to always be connected. We need to have some sort of a queuing mechanism so we can keep track of messages, retry messages if you've got downtime and these types of things. And if you want to provide some sort of an asynchronous high availability type scenario, you need to have these types of constructs. So message queues is another piece of our storage. Windows Azure Core Service Storage covers all three of those types. And then lastly, there's the tried and true relational database. So most line of business applications use relational databases in one way or the other. You can also do that inside of Windows Azure. The thing that's a little different about SQL Azure, which is essentially an offshoot of Microsoft SQL Server, is that SQL Azure is not just a database hosted on a virtual machine. It's actually a service that permeates the entire data center. So your database and your assets may be actually hosted on multiple machines in one of those containers or across containers, and there's a service at the high level that's managing it for you. So now you can essentially scale out your relational data as well as your NoSQL, your semi-structured data. So those are all core services that you as a developer have access to. There's a bunch more, actually, that are more enterprise-level services doing connectivity, identity management, data synchronization, lots of pieces to the whole package. All of them are sort of pay for what you use, so it's a very a la carte type scenario. But from starting from the ground up, building a phone application, for instance, you're going to make use of compute and storage. You're going to make use of them from essentially whatever technology you'd like. If you're putting something inside of Windows Azure, what you're doing is you're hosting something on a Windows Server machine that's in the cloud. You can run a lot of things on Windows Server. It doesn't have to be .NET. It can be PHP. It can be Node.js. It can be Ruby. It can be Python. It could be essentially any language, any environment that you're used to using sort of on-premises, you can use up into the cloud as well. Visual Studio offers a first-class development environment for .NET applications. But we also have an Eclipse plugin as well. If you're doing Java applications, you want to deploy Java services to the cloud, you can use the Eclipse plugin as well. So that was the rapid fire intro to Windows Azure. How do we make use of it in the Windows Phone? So there's a lot of these core services. I talked about web services. I talked about NoSQL storage. All that sounds very low level, a lot of plumbing. And indeed it is. So what we've done is we've provided a Windows Azure toolkit for Windows Phone, another very generic, boring name, shortened to WATWP. I can't even pronounce the acronym. We'll get the marketing people on that. But anyway, what this is a open source set of packages and actually guidance as well that take all of those core technologies I talked about, the Windows Azure storage, the compute, and build up some wrappers around them that make them very, very easy to use with Windows Phone. So when Todd went into Visual Studio and he started showing you things like the map chooser task and those types of things, and those types of abstractions, this is going to give you that same type of abstraction. An abstraction says basically save this piece of information to blob storage. You don't have to do a lot of the low-level underlying REST protocol calls that actually are happening as a result of you pushing something up to blob storage, you're just given a nice encapsulated object that says, save this data. So let's take a look at two examples that are actually part of that toolkit. The first is called Tweet My Blob. And what this is, let me just, is a simple phone application that allows me to take a picture and push it up to Twitter. And I thought I had Visual Studio running. Is it not there? There it is. So I won't go into the structure of the code much at all. I just wanted to show you a couple of different things that are on the side here. So this second project in the middle there is the phone project. So this is very much like what Todd was showing you with the MVVM model and so on. The other two projects that are in here that are a little bit lower down are what we use for Windows Azure. So there's a web project. And what this web project is allowing me to do is provide essentially a proxy service in front of storage. So I can talk to this web service and basically say, here's my blob, go store it for me. Okay, so it's a web service. And then above that is another project that is actually the Azure service. So the tweetyourblobs.web looks like an ASP.NET application, and it is. It's simply an ASP.NET application. There's nothing cloudy about it. Some of the calls it's making internally are talking to the cloud, but in general, that is just an ASP.NET application. What makes it a cloud application is the fact that there's this wrapper project on top of it called Tweet Your Blobs, and that's basically telling the cloud when it gets deployed that I've got this ASP.NET application. I expect a lot of people to be using it, so go deploy it on 6 different virtual machines. And by the way, I need a virtual machine that's got 4 cores on it versus one that has only 1 core. So that configuration that's part of that project is telling Windows Azure how to deploy my application. It's very simple. It's just essentially configuration. Now, let me just run this from within the Windows Azure, the Visual Studio development environment. The cloud's taking over the entire development environment, apparently. I'm running essentially a cloud application inside of Visual Studio. So you'll see the dialog that came up underneath this talks about a Windows Azure Cloud emulator. So I've got two emulators that are actually running here. The first emulator is the phone emulator that, that didn't look good. Continue. All right, that's fine. The first emulator is the phone emulator that Todd was showing you. There's actually a second emulator that pretends it's the cloud. So on my machine, it's running services that pretend that they are compute, that they pretend that they are the NoSQL storage. So it's all being emulated so that I can do my development, my testing in a very, very quick fashion. I don't actually have to pay to go to the cloud to test my application. And it's much faster that way as well. So it's come up. And let me go ahead and go into the emulator and call Tweet My Blobs. I'm going to install a certificate because we're making some HTTP calls. So this is something that you'll end up doing once, and then you'll be done with it. Certificates are installed, so I'll go back to the application. All right, so now I'm going to take a picture. Now, the camera on the emulator doesn't do a whole lot because there's no real camera, so you get this little box that moves around. So I can pretend to take a picture. So let's pretend to take a picture. Okay, it's taken that picture. I can say accept. Now it's going to hand that picture back over to my application. And it's going to essentially allow me to tweet it to the masses. So at this point, it's uploaded the picture. And it's asking me for my Twitter handle. And I wish the keyboard worked, but it doesn't. So I got to type in one by one. I'm sorry?
Page up.
Page up? Sweet.
That's why the tools guys are in the room.
Exactly. Wow, I didn't know I could do that. Very cool. Ah. Of course, I'm better when I type it in more methodically, right? Did I get it wrong again?
Is your username?
Yes. There we go. All right. So now it's essentially gone to the mobile Twitter and it's basically saying, check out this awesome pic. All right. We'll just do it that way. I don't want to spend time trying to make a nice picture, a nice message out of it. So I'll go tweet. So let me go down to my Twitter feed. This is just a really cheap way to get you guys to follow me.
So you've had 1,700 tweets, but 1,500.
I have been testing this app, yes, exactly. That hasn't refreshed yet. It should be, it should have come in. So we'll just leave that up there. What I'd like to do, let me just go right to this, back to the slide. It was a lot quicker when I was in the audience there. So briefly, what did we just do? What we did is we used the camera, we took a picture, we sent that picture up to Windows Azure, we used a proxy service so that we didn't have to actually have the credentials of my storage account actually on the phone. That's why we have a proxy service, because we don't want to store the user ID and password of my storage service on the phone. Then we actually called Bitly and said, I have a blob that is at this URL in my storage account. Can you give me a Bitly version of that? And then we essentially launched Internet Explorer on the phone and launched the Twitter feed or the Twitter page. And I tweeted from the Twitter page. And hopefully, I should have gotten a tweet back that basically says that we tweeted the blob. And right on cue, check this awesome pic. And of course, it's the dancing rectangle. And the rest of my Twitter followers are wondering, what the hell is he doing? Because they've seen about five of these today. So, all right, let me show you one more. And this one's actually on the phone, so it's a little cooler. This one's actually called Babelcam. And so let me see if I can get this choreography right. Document camera. So the code for all this is available as well, but it just works much better on the phone. All right. So what this is an application that actually one of our evangelists put together. It's asking me to log in. So I'm not going to log in because it's just easier not to, because then we have an out at the bottom. But if I want to go log in with Windows Live ID, for instance, or Google or whoever, I can provide my credentials here. And it will essentially authenticate me with that identity provider and then pass me back a token so then I can continue with my application. So the whole OAuth sort of synchronization dance is available to you. And I'm using a service inside of Windows Azure called the Access Control Service to do this. So this is literally just a few lines of code and some markup to make this happen. Now, I don't want to do all that because I don't want to risk typing my password in again. So what I'm going to do is use the application. What the application does is essentially takes a picture of whatever text you're reading. So say you're at a French restaurant and you can't read the menu. So you take a picture of the menu, and this is not a menu, obviously, but I will take a picture of some really boring document that I happen to have in my backpack. Nope, I hit the wrong button. One more time. All right, so what I did is just take another picture, same thing we did earlier. Now I've, well, that doesn't help if I walk away, does it? So it's got the picture, and now it's essentially going to translate the text into a different language. So I go to English, which is rather boring. So let's go to English to German. It's all Greek to me anyway. Let's go to German, because I can recognize a few of those words. And what I'm doing now is uploading the picture. So this is the same thing we did in Tweet My Blob, right? But what's going to happen additionally is once the picture's been uploaded, and it takes a little bit of time, a minute or so to upload, once the picture's been uploaded, I'm going to call another service. So we've got another Azure service in there that's going to interact with the Bing translation service, and it's also going to interact with a OCR recognition service that we have up in the cloud as well. So it's passing some stuff around in the cloud, and once it's done translating it, what it's going to do is going to send a notification back to my phone that says, hey, I'm done, and oh, by the way, this is what I just read out of the document. So this is the translation of Jim Starkey's bio, and I'm trying to see if there's any words. Data bank, you can see this is about big data, so there's probably a bunch of words about databases and so on. You can see system DBMS and all that kind of stuff in there. So this is sort of an end-to-end type of solution where you're taking advantage of both storage services, and then a very cool feature called push notifications, which other phone vendors have as well. The idea that we're actually pushing information down to your phone when there's something interesting to tell you. Now, if we go back to the slides, let me just do the quick. So, Babelcam, Windows Azure, we're First thing we did was try to authenticate, and I bypassed this, but as you can see, I can use essentially OAuth authentication to any of the providers that provide that, and set it up so that you can log in with whatever kind of ID semantics you want. We took the picture, we uploaded the picture to Blob Storage, very much like we did with the tweeting. Then we called another service that takes that image out of Blob Storage and basically passes it on to the Bing Translator in another project we call Hawaii, which does OCR, optical character recognition. So it took the picture and did the text recognition. When it was done, it passed it back and basically said, hey, I'm done. My service, that's the one with the gears right there, said, I've got something interesting to tell you. I'm going to use our push notification network and send that back to the phone. And then at that point, the phone application actually went back and got the data. The push notification doesn't actually send all of that data. It just basically tells you something interesting has happened, and it's up to the phone or up to you to go and see what that interesting thing was. And that's essentially the application. Now, beyond all this, a lot of the stuff I did here with Windows Phone is all Azure stuff is accessible through REST. So that means there's an iOS toolkit, there's an Android toolkit, and there's even a social gaming toolkit that takes some of these concepts that are important for you building games, like leaderboards, like sharing with friends, invitations, virtual currency, these types of things. And we've put essentially wrappers and scenarios around those as well. So you can download the social gaming toolkit and certainly be well on your way to building the next game. And because we have the various different toolkits, you could go to all three marketplaces and make, you know, triple the money that you might have made in just going to one. And that's it. I'm a few minutes behind. Oh, I'm a few minutes over. I appreciate the indulgence, but thank you very much.
Some of the stuff that Jim was just showing us, because of the authentication, does that mean that the app only knows the token that that authorized? It doesn't know the user ID that's associated with it?
You repeat the question.
I was on that. Damn, I didn't need the... So just kidding. I was going to be the only one that got that right tonight. Anyway, so the question was, because of the way the authentication works and the fact that I'm getting passed back a token from the access control service, does the application know who the user is or the user email or what have you? And the answer is it depends. So what happens is you authenticate to this third-party service and you get back what are called a list of claims. So you get back whatever that service is willing to tell you. And in some cases, Google App Engine, Google ID, Facebook will give you, I believe, the user ID, so like the email, and they'll give you the name and maybe one other bit of information. Live ID, Windows Live ID, gives you this very arcane just string. So if I did something with Windows Live ID and I wanted to say hello so-and-so, it would say hello some GUID, because I can't get that information. It's a privacy issue. So short answer is it depends. So in a lot of cases, what you'll have to do is you'll have to store information that's useful for your application separately that's keyed by whatever token or claim comes down from the provider.
As a follow-up, the example, I'm sorry, I'm awful with names.
Todd.
When Todd was showing pulling down the contacts, how contacts are presented from the SDK. Is for privacy reasons, that's also locked down, so you can't have an app that basically trolls your contact lists and sucks up that information to a third party?
Correct. So there are entry points into things. Oh, the question. Now I did forget. well. Anyway, so the question was, Todd showed some information about pulling down contacts and so on. Is there a way to keep applications from essentially trolling the whole list and spamming everyone, those types of things? So the access to a lot of the infrastructure of the phone, like the contacts, like maps and so on, is controlled by these things called launchers and choosers. So you have very gated access to these things, and you can get back certain pieces of information, but it's not like there's a database of names that you can open up, you know, file open and start going through.
But requires user interaction.
It does require, also requires user interaction as well, yeah. And there, when we go through the marketplace certification as well, they may or may not have other things that you're trying to do in your application that won't pass muster as well.
Along the same lines, maybe just ask, what's the concept of a hybrid application
when it comes to, I guess maybe a question for you, on the Windows Phone, like is there a phone gap type of...
So what's the concept of a hybrid application on Windows Phone? Is there a phone gap? And yeah, there is a phone gap. So you can use phone gap with Windows Phone as well. You can build essentially HTML5 experiences with phone gap. And there's another one called app. What's it? There's another similar type of tool that sort of abstracts things. So you could build it once for multiple different platforms. There's actually a tool called Mono for Droid and Mono Touch, which allow you to use the C# development platform and the development environment to target other phones as well.
So you can write Silverlight or C# to access the specific hardware of the phone and pass it off to the browser app type of thing.
In general, yes. There is. I mean, there's going to be some edge cases where you're not going to be able to perhaps do certain things, and you can also do Silverlight and XNA as well. So the gaming scenario and the more data binding business line of business type scenario, you can mesh those up as well. Oh, question way over there.
I missed it, but for Windows Azure, can you implement the backend service, or is it all?
So for Windows Azure, can you implement a back-end service? So everything is a back-end service. So with Windows Azure, when I wrote this proxy to go to the data and pull out the blob, for instance, or the other proxy that talks to the translator service, all that can run locally on my machine, which it was in the emulator, but that's all going to be deployed out to the data center. Yeah.
Any other questions? Hey, Jim, I know you run a lot of events for pro devs here. Do you want to, pitch it real quick?
Oh, you're going to make me try to remember what they all are now.
Well, I mean,
actually, yeah, let me point you to two resources so you kind of know what's going on. And they're both blogs. So one is my blog. And actually, let me just bring up Notepad so you'll be able to read it. So if you go to HTTP... This is me. Let's see, view, I always forget how to font.
Yep.
Make it big, okay, there we go. And my colleague is Chris Bowen, and we do exactly the same thing in terms of outreach. Chris has been a lot more focused on Windows 8. I've been more focused on cloud, and we sort of cover phone between us. Both of us have blogs fairly active, and we both are really keen on putting calendars out there on when events are coming up and blogging about events and so on. So there are definitely things coming up weekly. A lot of stuff downtown in Cambridge at NERD, for instance, but there's certainly a lot of events in the outer areas as well. So follow those two.
Yeah, actually, I'm running a... get on camera. Otherwise, it's a ghost voice.
Yeah.
Next Wednesday, the 25th, in Waltham, Massachusetts, we are actually doing a half-day afternoon on the next release of Visual Studio. But I honestly don't know what the registration link is for that, but I suspect if you go to Microsoft.com/events, it should be
or
relatively
you can go to my blog
easy to
and
find.
See the Visual Studio 2011
see?
ALM Roadshow.
My event, but he's got the link. So there you go. So that's up and down the East Coast, but in Waltham on next Wednesday, the 25th.
There you go.
So
that's free event.
Oh yes, free
with food. Mine has food. You have food.
We have food.
Yeah. So they all have food too.
I don't know if this has food.
This has
food. Is your event.
Yeah. This has food. Pizza.
Have food.
Pizza.
Oh, it's always pizza. Yes.
It's always pizza.
Gotta like pizza.
So. All right.
Any other questions before we jet? All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, guys.